All right, we are officially live. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Let me sort some windows out and all that good stuff. There we go. That looks good. Looks like we got some folks in the house already. Everyone. Got Terry Bear. Thank you, Terry Bear. Always a pleasure having you here. Six String Stanger. Let's see what we got here. I'm going to celebrate tonight since it's the weekend of New Year's. I'm going to do a little Stella Cider, Premium Cider, Vibro Steve, Habs, Ron Padgett, Rip Lead. So we're going to have Pixie Licks joining us this evening. And we also are going to unbox some really cool stuff. Devin, what's going on? Josh from Alaska. Andy Four, what is going on? Hello, hello. I'm drinking. Take a picture. It will last longer. Absolutely. So, everyone, here is my virtual cheers to a great 2017 and a very optimistic 2018. So, cheers, everyone. Cheers. Six String Stanger from Ohio. We got Jonathan Levitt, Devin, Resurrectionist, Dry Heat. Happy New Year's, everyone. The stream didn't start for you, dude, Terry Bear? Cheers, everyone. Metalhead Hippie. Flip Side, Dana. Ed Dana, hello. Mad Raj in the house. Vibro Steve, Andy, Kurt. Showman Blues, Happy New Year. Happy New Year to everyone. Let me clean my glasses. I think I have a little bit of a blur. What a year, huh? I'll tell you what I'm sipping in just one quick sec. Let me just clean these a little bit because things are looking blurry. May not be my glasses. May actually be blurry in my eyes. There he is. Pixie Licks in the house. I got to put headset on. Hang on.
Put my mic.
Pixie, can you hear me, buddy?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Nope. Hold on. It would be better if I plug you in. Let's do it this way. Hang on. Of course, I can't see the side of my computer. I'm sorry, everybody. Hang on just one second here.
Oh, that's right. You're...
Pixie, talk to me.
Check 1, 2, 3.
Nope.
9, 12.
Oh, I think I have to come over here real quick.
Here.
Oh, there you go.
Yes.
Headphones. Pixie, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right, good. And now I can officially hear you. So I am celebrating tonight. Pixie, cheers. And some folks asked what I was having. I'm having a Stella Cider, a premium cider to bring in the new year.
You sip it, you scream, Stella!
So cheers, everyone. So, how's everyone doing? Everyone doing good? Everyone having fun? Everyone have a good year? I'd love to know what the highlights were. What's the good? Don't want to talk about anything bad because we move forward. And also want to know what everyone is looking forward to for New Year's. Pixie, what's your New Year's resolution, buddy?
To be nicer.
People. Really? Dude, you're already nice.
Yeah, you know, you think that, but maybe people would tell me I'm not nice.
Nice.
Well, it happens. But I'm going to try and be a little nicer. If I can.
Oh, you could do it. Dude, if you're nice to me, you could be nice to anyone. Because I bring out the worst in people sometimes, I think.
It happens.
Requiem Dead said, fantastic, awesome year. The highlight for him was finding out. You and your wife are having a baby. Well, Requiem Dead, congratulations, buddy. That's exciting times, man. Cheers. Cheers.
Cheers. Is it your first? If it is, get ready. Because it's it is life changing for the better, but boy, it is.
Wow, Mad Raj said highlight for him was joining the live webcast. Well, dude, flattery at its finest. So thank you, buddy. Thank you. Chris says met Pixie at him last year. He's very nice. He's very nice. So
I try to be.
Yeah.
But I can tell you, when you're in Manhattan, the several days leading up to New Year's,
yeah,
sidewalk is like a concert just got let out. Even I have my patience. One thin.
Do you notice something changed back here since we spoke last, Pixie Licks?
Hold on, I'm partially obscuring my with what? Oh, did you move? Oh, Black Star.
I think I'd switch it up a little bit.
I had to move the I get the comments rolling, so
Yeah.
Yeah, that's nice. Black Star, huh?
Yeah. You wanna hear it? You guys wanna hear a quick little riffage? Sure. So you could tell me if the levels are good and all that, so everyone always wants to know. Oh, by the way, Pixie, you'll be happy to see what I'm using right here. I'm using the Pixie Licks.
Nice.
Doorman. So let's see what we can do here.
I like Doorman.
So this is going through the Torpedo, even though I'm not using the cab for like IR. I'm just using the Torpedo to attenuate it a little bit, which I really don't need to do because this amp has a 100 watt to 10 watt attenuator. You notice a lot of amps have attenuation built in now. You know. Does your Hughes and Kettner have attenuation, Pixie?
It does. It has, I think 40, 20?
A bunch. It's like...
I think, or 5-in-1? Or 3-in-1? It's got like... Either three or four, at least four stages, I think.
Yeah, of attenuation.
Yeah.
Which is smart for a tube amp company to do because, you know, tube amps are typically real loud, right? So if you want to crank it in the apartment, it's too loud? Or are we good?
I like it, but.
That was okay? All right. Check.
That's how it's at the studio.
It is set to studio.
Okay, just double checking before you
go on. So there you go. There's your quick little opening riff.
Nice.
Yeah.
I like it.
So, yeah, fiddling around with that. But I was saying right before you joined, Pixie, I was saying that I have some new stuff to unbox and, some new demos. I'm still backlogged with some of the stuff that I have. Did you do all your demos from GitCon, the stuff that came in from GitCon? Because I am late.
Oh, I'm late, too.
Why am I hearing myself talk?
Can you hear yourself talk now?
Yeah, now I can. It's weird.
Did I screw something up? Hold on. That better?
Oh, yeah. What happened?
Well, I changed mine to studio to get a little bit better voice quality. It seems like we both can't be on it.
What are you on right now?
Standard or communications, whatever they call it. What do they call it? Voice.
What does that mean? Like, right now, I'm actually on...
No, it comes at Tamano.
So I'm on headphones.
Yeah, but below that.
Oh, yeah. I'm on studio. I'm on studio.
Yeah.
So Which I think...
Studio, it seemed like, what, you were getting a little...
I started to hear myself. Yeah. Hmm.
All right. Well, we better not mess with the Google.
So the Black Star altered time and space. So Dan of New Jersey, did you like the Black Star? I need to spend a little bit more time with the Black Star. I have a confession to make. One of the best sounding amps I actually have is that Series 150 over there. It sounds like the perfect Marshall, really. You know, if you could make a Marshall sound rich and full, that's what that amp sounds like, you know. Trippy, groovy tape echo, guys. Is that is are the levels okay? Is anyone hearing a delay, or are we good?
Yeah, Mike, is it sounding okay? Check 1 2 to the 1 2. They're saying I sound a little underwater, but that's what happens. It probably when I was switching it.
Yeah, let's do this. Levels are okay, all is good. Okay, everyone's saying all is good.
Okay.
Phil Smith in the house, hello. So, what do you say I get right to showing you guys some gear? Let me go get a box. I have a couple of things I want to show you. Let me go get that. Give me 30 seconds. I'll be right with you.
Well, looks like it's you and me, guys. How's it going, everyone? Looks like I saw a few people I know on here. Human. I saw Terry in. Did I? Terry. Anthony.
So, I even have cue cards here. Let's see. Which was, I'll tell you, it was really nice. After I show you what's in the box, I'll show you the cue card because this was done really nicely. So this card here says, I have my cue card prepared by the company. So it says, "Dear Tone King, here is the Dan Electro 84 guitar, a reproduction of a guitar that Stevie Ray Vaughan commissioned late in 1983." Did you know
Oh,
that?
I did not. I was saying that's awesome. I had no idea.
Exactly. And that's my point. I'm like, wow, they gave me like the inside scoop. So I'll continue. It contained three Dan Electro lipstick pickups. Stevie played this guitar in Montreal, Montreux. How do you pronounce that?
Montreal? I can
Montreux.
slight French accent.
Montreal.
Montreux?
Montreux. Okay.
Like, as in Bonzo's Montreux?
I need my Canadian speaking. I mean my French speaking friends to keep me honest here. Montreux. Is that how you pronounce it? So it contained three Dan Electro pickups. Stevie played this guitar in at Montreux in 1985. Montreux in 1985. The live recording of that show highlights the awesome and unique tone of that guitar. So, look for Stevie Ray Vaughan Montreux 1985, and you should see a guitar that's going to look just like the one I'm going to take out of this box. Okay? This particular guitar has the Red Burst finish, which was a popular guitar finish in the mid 60s. Thought my cat just walked over here. In the mid 60s on Japanese made guitars. Have fun with it. Right? So here we go.
Nice.
Isn't that a nice card?
Very nice.
So if you guys want to just take a peek at that. I've gotten like little thank you notes and enjoy, but this was really a nice touch. So let's pop this bad boy open. I'll tell you, I was excited to know about the guitar. I was even more excited to read the cue card because I had no idea. It's always nice to get.
It's a nice touch.
It's a really nice touch.
Yeah, I think when Keeley sent me, and it wasn't Robert Keeley, but the guy was named Robbie over there. And it's a very nice note with it. It's a nice little touch rather than having
Absolutely.
to show up. Someone in the comments is saying that guitar might have a really large neck, which would make sense with Stevie Ray. Let's see how it compares to the Phil X, which also has
Huge neck, yeah.
that, yeah.
Okay, so that's out. I'll show that to you in one sec. I was trying to slide out instead of doing the deadlift.
Terry, you did miss a live stream. I did a test stream last night, and I don't think I started it until like 1 a.m. So, you know, you're probably it should be.
Okay, so I'll put that over there.
Great.
All right, so we have a box.
A nice looking box you got there.
Okay.
I'll tell you how many times I've said that.
I think if YouTube has done nothing else, it's given a new appreciation of unboxing. People love to watch things, you know, I'll be honest with you, I do the same thing. When there's something I'm interested in, I always look for the, you know, walk me through. Was everything in it that's supposed to be in it? You know, that type of thing, right?
Right.
All right.
Don't.
Oh, I'm dropping things now. Got a trem arm and some tools, which I saved. Wow. How's the color on that?
Coming through pretty nice. It looks like a fade from a lighter brown to either a dark brown or a black at the edge.
Yep. There it is. A nice looking guitar. So it has the Wilkinson WVS-52K. That's what it says anyway.
I recognize that as a Wilkinson trem right away.
Yeah.
What a same as what they put on Carvin.
What'd you say?
Same as Carvin. Carvin uses a lot of Wilkinson trems.
Let's get this plugged in. This up real quick. Where did I put my? Where did I put the pick? I still have my cell phone light on here.
Hate when that happens. Can't find a pick. I got a million guitars. Got a million amps. But where's the damn pick?
Hey, where is the pick? Did I put it in my pocket? I don't know where my pick is.
Your pick.
Your pick. Oh, here it is. Okay. So let's see what we have here. Let me throw the tuner on. That's a little off. Hang on.
Hey, someone was asking what model is that Black Star. I'm seeing MK2. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's the brand new one.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to a clean channel. I'll back up so you could see it. So, Pixie, what do you know about lipstick pickups?
They're found mainly in surf guitars, and it has a certain twang to it, as far as I know.
Oh, I just screwed that one up.
Sounds like I would expect it a little bit on the brighter side with the lipsticks. Like someone said in the comments, clarity, very clear.
Yeah. Brandon says sounds fantastic. Let me just check the tuning one more time. Sounded a little off.
Well, they're brand new strings.
Yeah, I got to stretch them and all that.
You know.
Thank you.
How's the neck?
It's a little thick. I would say it's not as thick as the Phil X. No. What'd you say? The weight feels fine. I'm not really good at knowing how
like,
much.
Like a Strat or a little heavier, a little lighter?
No, I would say it feels like a Strat would sound. Isn't that a stunning looking guitar though?
It does look nice.
So this is the 1984. I'll show you the back. Even the back has the little burst going on. Those are, I guess, vintage style tuners.
Looks like vintage Cluson styles.
Yep.
A little round.
I like the headstock. It's got a nice chunky headstock to it. So I didn't know Stevie Ray Vaughan played one of these.
Yeah, that's weird. I had no idea either.
I'll tell you, when you go to the neck pickup, it's got a good amount of balls to it.
On the specs,
yeah,
double cutaway offset horn shape, scale length of 25 and a half, 22 frets with a graphite nut, Wilkinson vibrato bridge, 3 single coil lipstick pickups, 1 master, 1 volume, 1 master tone, a 5-way pickup switch.
Sounds great. I like it. What a nice looking guitar. So that was one of the things I wanted to show you. And it's funny because I rarely play Strats. But really, you know, I'm not into the Me Too guitars. You know what I mean? Which probably explains why I like the Invey so much. It's definitely not the Me Too Strat, right? It's very, very different, very unique. But also, if you notice, 1 volume, 1 tone. So, interesting. Okay, let me throw that on standby. Let me throw my that over there. I'm gonna do a quick switch with the Phil X. Put that back there. Actually,
Black Corvo throwing you a little.
What'd you say?
The Black Corvo. Give me a happy new year.
Dude, happy new year, Black Corvo. Thank you, man. Thank you. In fact, from me to you, doing a little Stella cider this evening. Let's have a drink.
Coffee.
Yeah.
12:24 a.m.
That means you're gonna be up for a long time.
Not really.
No. By the way, does everybody like Pixie Lix's new background?
Oh yeah, that's right. This my wall.
That is a nice wall.
That is a nice wall. That wall was a bit of a ball buster to make, but it was done right.
Yeah.
Like that wall is strong enough to be like technically a load bearing wall on the exterior sheathing of a house. I used the identical materials.
Wow.
Oh yeah. I did full 2x4 studs with pressure treated bottom and oriented strand board. I want to say OBS, but it's OSB. We were just talking OBS like for like an hour. Oriented strand board. It's nice.
So speaking of OBS, for those that don't know, there's a lot of different pieces of software you could use to stream. And last night I texted Pixie and I said, Pixie, can you help me with OBS? Because I was struggling with the Mac. What else is new? So he gets home today, he texts me, we get on, and man, it's just total struggle. So we had OBS running on the MacBook Pro, dropping just crazy amount of frame rates. I was like, you know what? Let's go back to the PC.
Well, what was funny is that you were dropping 23%, 25%. I said, well, let's make a few adjustments. Then you were like 80, 85% dropping. I was like, oh, that's in the wrong direction.
Yep. So there's one more thing I want to show everybody. So let me go get that. Give me 1 second, and then we'll just talk and hang. Hang on.
Okay. Well, he's gone. I'll give you a little bit more detail about the wall, which I'm having a live show tomorrow night, and I'll give you more detail about it. But the outside here, this covering is obviously like a faux wood. But what's great is that they really do get the like the texture down right. Right, so it does look kind of semi-real, and it's super durable, right? So it won't scratch. It's pretty durable. I just felt like I needed something better than the cement, you know, than the concrete. And I had a giant waste pipe running down the middle of it, like hell. So I wanted to cover that up. And it has another wall coming out here. I have all these monitors mounted to the wall. And I'll probably be shooting a lot of the videos this direction.
And right, so you have that.
The live shows will still be this direction. I almost took the corner down there, like I said, but it's too much to box in the utilities.
Right.
Like the footprint cost of doing that in this room is just too great.
Right. Well, definitely looks nice. Your wall needs a pick.
Yes, someone said old pallets are awesome. That's literally what this covering is called. It's called vintage pallet.
Yeah. It's nice. It almost looks like that reclaimed look.
Yeah. I mean, it could hold 200 guitars. It's got like such strength to the friggin' wall.
You think that's ever happened to a store where they put on the guitars and all of a sudden it starts to...
Hey, I almost knocked down the wall at, what was it, Schecter or ESP? Remember, were you there with me?
I wasn't there, but I heard the story.
There. Oh, yeah. I forget if it might have been Schecter.
I'm being asked to put on the sign. Hang on.
Oh, God. Imagine if that wall came down, dude. That was like a $30,000 wall. That would have cost me. The Lixie Lounge? Oh, people are naming it? People are naming it on the... Okay. Lixie Lounge. That works. It has the alliteration we all love.
All right. Now it's really official. I got the sign lit. So here's the second cue card. You want to hear the second cue card I got?
Okay.
Okay. So here we go. Hey, Tone King.
Sorry.
Oh, no problem. Here are the new pedals. Texas Pedal does a great SRV tone simulation. So that's this one right here.
This one?
That one. That one. That's right. There you go. So the Texas Pedal does a great SRV tone simulation, but a lot more. Okay? The Boost Pedal is a remake of the 1980s pedal still used by The Edge and David Gilmour. This one right here. Now, here's my question. Here's the trivia question. What is the remake of the 1980s pedal called? Is it, because I don't think it would have been called Million Dollar Boost. Would it have been? So what is this the remake of? What did The Edge and David Gilmour use in the 1980s?
I don't. Right, that's probably a recreation of whatever they used.
Yeah, so that's my question. What was it that they used? And it says, so let me read the whole sentence. Boost pedal is a remake of the 1980s pedal still used by The Edge and David Gilmour, responsible in part for their great tone. What would it that? Could that have been like a Big Muff or something like that? No, because that's not a Boost.
It's a Boost. So what was
The FET driver. That was a very popular one. The Edge used that FET driver.
Right, right. You wonder if it's that. If it's an FET.
In fact, I think the Edge, that was one of the, because he always had like all the rack stuff, but he always had that, I think it was called like the FET Boost, maybe. Maybe that's what it was called. Anyway, spinning speaker tips. Where is that one?
That's the Big Spender.
That is the Big Spend. We're going to talk about these titles as soon as I'm done with the cue card. We're going to go through these titles. So the spinning speaker, plug in the DC jack first, then in and out cables. Hit effects foot switch and then ramp switch to start things spinning.
Yeah. So you know what the ramp switch does?
No.
Okay. So have you ever gone to a roller rink where the guy played the organ? You ever done that? You ever gone to a roller rink and the guy's got an organ in his mind?
I've been to a roller rink, but I don't think I...
You never gone when the guy has... Or sometimes even a hockey game, they'll have the organ too, right? It's a Leslie, and he's working the pedal. So the rotation is speeding up and slowing down, and he's working that with his foot, right?
Okay.
It makes a huge difference. It doesn't do that. It's not like MASH technology where it makes a difference when you apply pressure to it.
Okay.
Or like you hit it once and it starts to speed up. And then you hit it again, and it starts to slow down.
Okay.
So it's like speeding up and slowing down, and you can change it. It'll start to go up, and then it'll hit a point, and then it'll be done. And I think it flashes while it's moving, and then it goes solid when it's at the end.
Got it. Okay.
See?
So what? Well, let me finish reading this, then I'll ask my question. The green LED lamp is the slowest speed. Hitting ramp switch advances to fastest spin, red LED.
Yeah, there you go. Okay. Right, so it moves between the green and the red LED.
Yep. And then we have the Filthy Rich Tremolo. Same circuit as the Dan Electro amp tremolos of the 1940s. Deep vintage swell. Have fun. And again, I'm so impressed by the cue cards. I want to share with everyone what that looks like. Isn't that a nice touch?
Very nice.
Okay. By the way, maybe Dan Electro had a Boost pedal then. I don't know. Did they? I have no idea. That's very possible. Before we do that, look at this. They all say that. True bypass switching, die cast case, hand sprayed classic car finish.
I got to admit, I do like that the retro look of them all. They all scream like, I don't even know if it's 60s. It's more like late 50s.
Yeah. So Bobby Beretta says, you really like packaging. You know, I do like packaging. I think it's, I don't know. It's like opening a guitar case for the first time. That new car smell, right? It's exciting.
Apple's made quite a living at good packaging.
Yes, I would agree.
It's an unboxing experience. The whole unboxing came from good packaging.
You're right.
Right?
They set the bar.
They really did. They really did. It was an unboxing experience.
Wow. Okay. So here is the Apple inspired unboxing experience. So you even have care once you open the box. See that? Inside the box. Okay.
All so these we subliminal messages.
Look at this.
They're the wealth.
So this says, love a billionaire. If you love your billionaire, please post photos and comments on social media. Also, any photos of you and your billionaire that we could post, please send to bigshot@danelectro. Thanks a billion.
Friends don't return my calls thing.
There you go.
So what do you think about the billionaire name?
Let's talk about that. You know, it's interesting that they went with...
Well, because I don't get a vintage vibe from that. That's my point. They're vintage pedals. They're a vintage vibe company. When I think of billionaire, there were no billionaires in the past, right?
So here's the thing. I don't know if you ever heard this story, but I'll tell you a quick story, because this is all about story time, isn't it? I was on a flight one time. Wow, what a nice pedal. It's all metal.
Yeah, no, it's nice.
Really, really, really nice pedal. So I was on an airplane one time. This is back in like 2009, 2010. I sat next to a guy who looked like Roger Daltrey. Literally looked like Roger Daltrey. So we got talking. And it turns out he's actually the lead singer of a Who cover band.
Wow.
Yes. And he and I started talking music, and I told him about thetoneking.com, and I go by the Tone King and all that stuff, right? And I said to him, because this is early days, right? I said, what do you think of the name? He said, I love the name. I said, why do you love the name? He said, because it's the king. Everybody wants to be the king.
Good to be the king.
It's good to be the king, right? So how does that relate to this, right? It's just filthy rich, big spender, you know, $1 billion boost. It's like the $1 million tone.
Right, the filthy rich. I get it. I think the weird thing, though, is that, like, it's, I don't know that I get to tie into more of the vintage aspect of it. That feels like more of like what a modern pedal would be marketed as. But what do I know?
I failed marketing. No.
Fail it, but you
know. The big spender isn't a modern day. You don't have millennials walking around saying, hey, big spender.
Yeah, no, that's true. That's true.
Big spender is an old fashioned.
Well, that's from the 40s. The 30s or 40s.
Yep.
That might have even come out of the Depression.
Yeah, even filthy rich. This is something like my grandmother would have said, you know?
Right.
So I like the play on the, you got the $1 million tone, right? Everybody wants to be the king. Everybody wants the $1 million tone. I like it. I think it's clever. And you know what? Are we tired of the same old super overdrive, super this, plus that?
Right.
It's like they went in a totally different direction. They're like, you know what? This is like casino style.
Yeah, right. Actually, it does have a very West Coast vibe to it. I thought all the stuff did.
Yeah. I feel but like this is sure. like, you know, this is casino style. You know, which I like. It's fun. It's supposed to be fun, right? Otherwise, it would be in a box that's not painted and some circuitry, and you just play it and it does what it's supposed to do. But it's more than that. What a nice looking pedal. Really, just if you haven't seen the 360 degree tour, this is it. You know, I want to put like four wheels and send it down the Cub Scout thing. What is that called?
Right, Pinewood Dunes.
We should.
You know, I took first place in that one year.
We should race the Dan Electro pedals down the Pinewood Derby.
We never ran a Pinewood Derby without leaving with a trophy. Fourth place, we ran three derbies. Fourth place, first place, fourth place. So we always showed the finals.
So a couple of people asked a question. Obviously, this came directly to me from Dan Electro. So Dan Electro, thank you for that, for giving me an opportunity to try the stuff, and also giving me an opportunity to demonstrate it for everybody to check out. So thank you from me to you. So with that said, I'm actually not sure of the prices. If you could, someone share that with everyone. I've done no research on this so far. This was just a friendly conversation I was having with Dan Electro about covering the line. I was very excited about it. I just explained why I was so excited about it. And I'll tell you, I got even more excited when I read the cue cards. I'm like, I had no idea that, you know, there was such this big tie-in to Stevie Ray Vaughan. And who's not a fan of Stevie Ray Vaughan? So Hab says, I feel like I need a Gibson Casino if I would use a $1 billion pedal. Oh, so I guess the Pride of Texas is like an 808. Is that what this is supposed to be reminiscent of, inspired by? Do you know, Pixie?
I wasn't hearing that in it.
No? Okay.
I mean, it could be, but I think the 808 is a little bit more mid, right? It's I hear, you know, if the Tube Screamer to me has a few more mids in it than that. If you check out my video on that, and I'm playing the Charvel, and I'm using the Duncan 59, and when I kick on the pedal, it almost goes from like a humbucker to like a single coil.
Hmm.
When it's all the way down, when it's at its least amount of dirt, right?
Mm-hmm.
On the gain, the gain's all the way down. And then it just ramps up from there.
Interesting.
And I thought it was a great sound of pedal.
Yeah, I may build like a little pedal board, throw them all up and check them out. But you guys want to see one more? Should I pop open another one? Stevie Ray Vaughan used a modified 808. So did anybody figure out, did I miss it in the comments? Boost pedal is a remake of the 1980s pedal still used by The Edge and David Gilmour, responsible in part for their great tone. Does anybody know what that's referring to? So I don't know. I love Stevie Ray Vaughan. I think he was a pioneer. I know he was like a blues guy.
Someone earlier in the chat was saying that it was like a modified, you know, Ibanez Tube Screamer.
Ah, okay. Got it.
Would make sense, right? If that's what people are saying, it's based on the...
See, I didn't know The Edge used a Tube Screamer.
I don't know.
I guess everybody used a Tube Screamer.
It was kind of one of the few. It's like you had, you know, maybe 10 or 15 distortion pedals on the market at the time.
Right. Right, like right.
Now we
right.
have like, you know, 4,000 distortion pedals on the market.
Yeah. So, you know what I liked? Since we're on the topic of Stevie Ray Vaughan, I started to say he was a pioneer. When you think about what we're doing here right now, talking about the gear, like he was a great guitarist. He had the riffs. He had the chops. He was in a band. He made great music. But he was a lot about the gear. The gear is what made his tone so big. You know, there were, you know, people used to say this guy would come with 2x10s, 4x10s, 1x12s, 1x15s, all running at the same time just because it sounded so big. You know, he understood the value in, you know, creating that. It's almost like the studio sound, right? Like a lot of artists get blamed for like, oh, it doesn't sound like that when I plug into their signature amp and their signature guitar, because in the studio they layer things. He was actually layering all that stuff live, which gave him such big tone. And I commend him for that. I mean, he was really into the gear.
Yeah, was it him that was turning the amps around to give the audience a break because they were just so friggin' loud? Or I think maybe he started to put the plexiglass up just to give the audience, because he would just crank those amps up, you know.
Yeah.
I could have seen him a couple of times.
Really?
Yeah, I missed both times. Said, "Oh, he'll be around again." The one I really missed was when he toured with Jeff Beck. Jeff Beck. He was on the was Guitar Shop with that album, which is a great album, very modern album for Beck. Jeff Beck in the late 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think he was touring on Guitar Shop, and he was touring with Stevie Ray Vaughan, and damn, I really wish I went to that show.
You know, somebody once told me that we're living in a renaissance period. And basically what that suggested was there's so much good music, you know, in the last decade, couple of decades. Like for instance, for us right now, you know, if you go to Lincoln Center as an example, you hear the opera, right? In 100 years from now, people might be going to Lincoln Center to see a Led Zeppelin tribute band. You know, we're living through a period of just really great music. And let's face it, we all have expiration dates, right? So at some point in the future, you know, people are going to be watching remakes of what we're getting to experience live. Think about that. You know,
plus, you know, for the first time in modern history, we really have like high resolution recordings of like so much stuff. You know, a lot of what was done was well documented in both film and audio and video and, you know, and all that. Whereas, you know, before that technology came along, you just didn't have it.
Right. But by the way, I just changed to voice. Does that sound any better to you, Pixie?
Sounds about the same.
Same thing. All right. So let me go back in case I decide to. Okay, I just went back to studio in case I decide to.
Well, you know what? You were a little louder. You were a little clearer, maybe.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's do that since we're just kind of chit chatting a little bit.
That's funny.
Yeah. So yeah. Black Corvo says, "Want to hear my amp project? I could do a quick sound sample, dude. I'd love to hear your amp project. Absolutely. If you could send me like an email link or something. I mean, you have my email. I'd love to check it out. Absolutely." Terry Bear says, "EVH Gear TV had on earlier Jennifer Batten. She talked about Jeff Beck and Michael Jackson. It was very cool." Oh, very cool. Very cool. You know, I keep missing his shows. I'd like to check him out. Did you ever check out one of the EVH Gear TV shows?
I check him out once in a while because I'm subscribed to him.
Yeah, yeah.
He does a lot of shows. He does a lot of live shows. He does very little pre-recorded stuff.
Right.
Most of his stuff is a live show. So he's running them all the time.
Yeah, I keep missing it. I don't know why. I just don't get notifications. It's odd. To YouTube and just see all my subscriptions that, you know, to catch what's live. Black Corvo wrote, "It's a madman's build at the moment. Wires everywhere." Dude, send pictures, send links. I'd love to check it out. You know, in fact, someday I'm convinced he's going to build, you know, he builds amps. Black Corvo builds amps. Really? Someday I'm going to, something will come to be where I'll be demoing the Black Corvo. You know, Terry Bear says, "I thought Pixie was on it." Oh, you were on the EVH TV?
I did an episode with him, yeah.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. Very cool. Very cool.
A while back, actually.
Hmm.
Yeah, I felt bad. We were trying to do it through Skype, and I couldn't get it going on my main computer, and I had to, like, go back to my 720p cam, which, I mean, it turned out okay, but I felt bad because I wanted to give him the best video quality I could get.
Sure.
I couldn't do it. I had to go back. The cam just could not answer the call. He kept ringing. I kept answering it, but it would not pick up. It just sort of stalled. He said, "Yeah, it just kept ringing on my end."
Really?
So, yeah, that's the end of that. I had to run to another computer, but all the technical glitches.
Right.
Wait, go on.
Tim says, "I need a 2203. That's very astute of you to see that I don't have a 2203 here. And I know one of them is like, the 2203 has the inputs that are vertical. You don't want the one that's horizontal. You want them vertical. Do I have that right? But I do have a 2205, which is somewhere back there. Right under the Saldana is my 2205. I think that's a 2205 right over there, my JCM800. So Pixie, here's something you should check out. I may treat myself in the new year. It's called Sling Studio. Did you ever hear of it?
No.
Okay. So, and by the way, I always get the question, what do you use and what kind of gear? And if you're even remotely interested in making YouTube videos or doing something streaming, listen to this because you'll appreciate it. So Sling Studio, one of the problems with doing videos, especially live streaming, is you have to use these dumb webcams, right? You can't take your $2,000 video camera and stream from it. It's not designed for that.
No, you can. You have to use the HDMI out, use a capture card, but that's a lot of overhead and it's a lot of expense. And
yes,
you know, the picture's probably better, but
yeah,
comes with some cost.
Right. So what Sling Studio does, it's all wireless. So you don't have wires everywhere. You have a hub. Think of your cable modem in your house, okay? And that connects to your internet and also serves as the wireless gateway for anything that you can connect to it. So then I could buy an adapter. This is all a self-contained unit. And I could put one on my XA20. I could put one on my T5i, you know, my DSLR and my video camera. Both of those will connect to this wireless hub. So if I'm doing a live stream, I could now use two cameras. The software is on the iPad. So I could say...
Wallman's using?
Yes. So I could set up a live stream right from the iPad. And when I'm talking, I could just touch the button and it will have the zoom on my face. And then, hey, let's check out the app. I touch the other button and it will go. You could have a multi-camera stream set up all just by having an iPad right here. Just tap, right?
That's pretty awesome.
Now, that's for a live because you could stream from the app with your real good cameras, not these $89 specials, right? The other cool thing is if you're doing a demo, like, right, because we do demos. I have two cameras plus a third audio source, and then I have to open Adobe. I have to stack them, sync them. It's a pain in the ass, okay? What this does is in that wireless hub, you put an SD card, and you tell it, like, if this camera is live, I want this audio source. So it could be, let's say, my Focusrite. And if this camera's live, I want a different audio source.
Right, so you compare the audio and video. And it
synchronizes everything, and it records it to an SD card. So right. You have the close-up shots, the wide-angle shots, different audio sources, depending on what shot, on a single SD card. It's done.
I'm just going to lay it out there.
Sounds
pricey.
Okay. So you're $1,300.
Okay.
The hub is a grand.
Okay.
You need, and the hub takes one HDMI input. So you could plug one camera directly into that, and then it's $300 for a camera connection. So if you wanted two wireless cameras, you'd be $1,600. So if you want two camera view, you're $1,300 because one of them could be hardwired right into the gateway. Now, $1,300 is a lot of money, no doubt about it. But if you think about the time it saves, if you could do a video, think about right now, if you wanted to do a video, have everything set up, I could do a video in one take and just upload it. I got that much time back in my life for every video.
Right, right. Yeah, no, the longest part of video production by far is the editing.
Yeah, and
it's not even close.
I said this a long time ago, and I'll say it again. It's my least favorite part, just not because I don't enjoy editing. It's a time.
Yeah.
I got a full-time job, no secret. I got three kids, no secret. It's time.
Yeah.
I could do a video which could take 15 minutes, and I could spend the next hour editing it.
Just the rendering time. When I'm shooting a 4K video,
right. My
rendering time is 2 minutes for every minute of footage.
The render doesn't bother me because I'm not in front of the computer. I walk away when it starts to render. I'll come back later and then just upload it. It's the editing.
Right.
And this Sling Studio, it's editing on the fly. You're just touching a button. All of a sudden, you're zoomed in on the amp controls, and it's using the audio source of, let's say, the 18i20.
Were we using that at GitCon?
You know, I was texting with David Wallerman, and I said to him, I said, dude, I said, I saw in your video you pressed a button and it zoomed in. What are you using? I picked up on that right away.
Right.
And he said that. And he said he learned about it at GitCon. I didn't see it at GitCon. So if it was there, yeah, I don't know.
He learned about it from Henning. So I think he got in a conversation about Henning about streamlining. Like, how do you record your videos where you're always switching around? And rather than getting, I think, the 4K switcher, he wound up getting the 1080p switcher. Maybe he did get the 4K switcher. But I think he was interested in it as a time saving step to say, look, I love to make the videos, but it would be a lot easier if I could just switch a whole bunch of cams. Even if I still have to go in there and tighten it up a little bit, it's not like I have to go in there and like bring in multiple shots. So I will say this, if you know Premiere really well, like who was the like Tom Quayle?
Yeah.
Like Tom Quayle knows the product so well that I have a feeling like he's running circles around us with his flow because he's so good at like pulling in multiple cams. He's like, just drag across, set a group, do this, blah, blah, it'll automatically recognize it. And then boom, you bring it up and you just switch between cameras and you can set up a set of hotkeys, which I have set up. And he just clicks through as it's running, right? It automatically synchronizes it and he runs through. And I'm like, that's pretty good.
You know? Listen, I could do it too.
But here's the thing. You got to go through that learning curve.
Yeah.
You know, and you still got to do the rendering. You still have to sit there and render that output. So just saving rendering time alone. You're saying you don't have to sit there and wait for it, but you know, when it's 1 o'clock in the morning and you want to post a video before you go to bed and you're waiting 25 minutes for that thing to render.
I know.
And you watch a video and you go, shit, I forgot a title.
You could take the SD card out at all the Zooms, all the audio sources, everything synchronized, and you just upload it.
Right.
Sounds like a beautiful. And if you want to touch it up, you throw that into Adobe and maybe put your intro and your outro over it, whatever.
A little bit, whatever you do, you're right.
But you still have to render it at that point.
True, you still got to render. You know you're never doing that.
Because the branding is important, right?
Right.
I'll tell you, that's if I had a feature request for all these cameras, video cameras, I should say, give me a lower left, a top right, a lower right to upload a PNG. So as it's recording, it will have my logo in there.
Right.
How hard could that be to have an overlay in the finished product?
Well, because it has to add it to each frame, and it's running at 30 frames a second. So, All right. So, might be hard.
Dude, you're adding too much logic. Come on.
Yeah.
As the consumer, I'm like, how difficult does that be?
And how can that be?
You just stand. Exactly.
I would have to store 30 frames per second overlaying.
Right. Wow. It sounded easier when I said, how hard could it be? And then you just rained on my parade. So, okay. Right. Got it. Oh, man. So, Phil, what do you think, buddy? Sling Studio. Phil's like the right-hand gear guru guy.
Is he really, yeah?
He and I email quite a bit, and he's just got some pretty tremendous insight.
Cool.
To all things gear.
Well, it says, hey, Pixie, how do you set your pickup height? You ever use an offset pickup height? I have used an offset pickup height, like on a Strat. I've done it. Tilt them a little bit. Pickup height really goes by feel and sound. If I don't like the sound of it, I feel like it's a little too weak or whatever. I'll raise it up a hair, but I tend to, you can't get them too close, so it really does send the tunes out of the strings out of tune. And you can hear because you're going to tune and your tune is all over the place. You're like, what the hell's going on? It's because the magnet's constantly pulling it out of tune as it vibrates and gets close to it. It's pulling it a little extra. So
you're 100% right. Pickup height is all about you hit a harmonic or something. And then if you too close, it's going to sound kind of warbly.
Yeah, wobbly. Yeah.
And if you back it off too much, it'll sound too thin. It's really, you got it. The pickup height's all about listening to it. I know they have documented like, if it's a humbucker, that's this. If you got to hit it.
It all depends on the DC resistance. So it's like, how hot is the pickup? And that's going to dictate it. So there's no set humbucker or Strat because there's so many different variations of each one of those style of pickup. Yeah. It's a little bit of touch and go. In fact, I kept the screwdriver for the longest time right next to my I was constantly going, I don't think I like that. Let me just screw this down like a half a turn and see if I like this a little better. Say, it didn't really make a difference. Maybe I'll put it back. Oh, wait, maybe I think it sounds too thin and I'll put it back, you know. You can make yourself mental about it, but you just gotta, eventually you'll find a spot and you'll say, you know what? That sounds pretty good right there.
Did I ever tell you my Harley Davidson story? About just ride your bike and enjoy it story?
Yeah, right. Yeah, you did, actually.
I'll give everybody the quick version. When I first got my bike, I own an 89 Sportster. And Pixie, did I show it to you when you were here or no?
I don't think so, no. Okay.
So I took my road test on that bike. I bought it when it was like 5 years old from some dude. He spent all this money with the tank and the chrome. Anyway, I was in Harley Davidson every other day. I hear this and I hear that and it's leaking here and do this. And finally, the owner said to me, he was like, dude, why don't you just ride your bike and enjoy your bike?
Right.
Like, you're spending all this time here. Go enjoy the bike. And, you know, you could take that and apply it to anything. Right. Because like you said, you could get mental over, you know, I don't remember exactly what you said, but you could drive yourself crazy.
Yeah. It's a death by 1,000 paper cuts.
Yeah. Just enjoy it. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. You get that way with gear too, right? It's like you get so crazy about it, but at some point it's just playing guitar.
Here's the other story I'll tell you. Cause I'm in technology. That's no secret. My early days when I worked for AT&T back in the day, there was a developer guy or some high senior level IT, whatever it was that he did, real smart guy. So he had this thing. He told me this. If something stops working, he then doesn't waste time trying to fix it. He goes around it. He said, I don't have enough time to fix it. Like kind of like what we did before, right? OBS wasn't working on the Mac. Screw it. Went to the PC. Problem solved.
Right.
You could spend all weekend trying to figure that out.
Yeah.
You know. So you just, you know, it what does it all come back down to? Time. That's the biggest obstacle. I've been saying that for years. It's the biggest obstacle. Because nobody has unlimited amounts of time.
No. No. Not even close. Ooh. Yeah, I polished my coffee off a while ago.
Want to go get a refill? You down for hanging?
At 1 o'clock is my official curfew.
Oh, is that right?
or for coffee drinking.
So Watchman says, that's what Harleys do. They leak oil to mark the spot. You got to do a bolt check every week. Yeah, yeah. You know, I'd like a Road King. I you know, my 89 Sportster is my insurance policy. I tell my wife this because if I ever sell it, you know a bigger bike is going to be right in that spot. So I keep it. I own it. It keeps me from buying another one. So what does the crystal ball say for 2018? What do you guys predict? What are the predictions? What do you think, Pixie? What are we gonna see at NAMM?
Well, you know, we're gonna see a new Marshall amp. We can't talk about it, but we both saw it. Did you see it when you were at KidCon?
I saw it, but I didn't spend any time with it.
Well, no one did because it was on lockdown. I brought an amp no one could show.
Was it like a code, another code?
No, it's a similar code. I don't want to get into it because I don't want to, you know, rain on
their parade. But it's a modeling, right?
It's a mod. No, no, I thought it was a tube amp.
Oh, see, I thought it was a modeling amp.
They might have had one modeling amp there. They had a few amps there.
Got it.
But their new one was not. It was a tube amp.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Small Marshall head. I'm reading the comments here. Yeah. I'd like to see. I'm always curious to see what's going. What is Charvel and Jackson going to do to? Because they're not really innovating, right? It's just. I think they're trying to it's the Fender syndrome, right? They try to leverage the legacy.
Right.
Coming out with a Jake E. Lee signature series, which they did it last winter NAMM, that's a legacy.
Right.
You know? What do you think we could expect to see from Jackson or Charvel? Or even Fender from that matter?
Who knows? You know, every year it just seems to be a new round of colors.
Quite. Yeah. Honest. Yeah.
The same body style, you know, with a new round of colors, and that seems to be most of the quote unquote innovation. Mm-hmm. They don't dare breathe because they, you know, they don't want to come up with a new guitar design that no one's into. And they've got these tried and true designs, and they can excite people just by painting it in a new color, apparently.
You know, you really got to, and this isn't a shameless plug for Line 6, okay? But you really got to give credit to companies like Line 6 because they innovate. Their whole, you know, like Fender is an example. I'm just picking on Fender for no good reason. Their whole strategy isn't necessarily innovation. It's about heritage and legacy.
Yeah, but I thought they've come out with some amps recently that have been pretty damn good. That Bass Breaker series, which I know was a nod to an old series, but it was like a newer version of an old series. And damn, that thing just sounded good. And what was the other one? You know who was the Boss Katana? Has anyone had a better year than Boss Katana? I mean, it seems like they really, you know, got a lot of love out in the market.
They did. You know, it was priced right. It's a Boss product. You know, they did well. And I'll be honest with you, I'm surprised they did as well as they did. By the way, I'm not talking financials. I have no idea how much they sold, but just from hearing it, you know, right. Yeah. I mean, it was, everyone says, yeah, as Hab said, it was a game changer.
So someone mentioned Wild Audio. What do you think happens with Wild Audio? You think they're going to give it another 12 months, or you think they're going to wind it down because they just don't have the sales to support the brand?
Dude, I'll be honest with you. I was in Guitar Center with my son last week. There was one in the back. I think that you said it yourself before, right? People, guitarists are very predictable, right? Think about it. Like that guitar, everyone got excited. Wow, what a pretty guitar. It's a Strat.
Right.
Right? But if it had these like horns and it had all this swirl, it would cater to a lot less people. It is what it is.
Right.
You know? I think that was the problem. Someone mentioned Ola England, Solar Guitars. I was actually chatting with Ola on Facebook. I love Ola. Ola's just such a nice guy.
He's a super nice guy.
Okay. And I told him, I said, I want to buy one of your guitars. It's funny. The one I wanted, the blood red, he didn't have anymore. He sold out like that. But his guitars are very, they're a little pointy. Okay, but they're very traditional. They're metal traditional,
right?
So he'll do well.
I think streamlined. If there's one word I can come up for those guitars, they look very streamlined. You know, it's like a design that's, you know, like a Ferrari.
Yeah, they're sharp. They're not over the top. So the one he had on his website was a blood red, just a double cutaway, nothing special. I'd like to get one of those. I told him, I said, dude, hit me up when you have them in stock. I'll pick one up, you know. And but, you know, I think when you take a guy like Ola England and you compare him to Zach Wild, I get nervous, to be honest with you, because when you see Wild Audio not doing well, you know, Ola's a friend. I want him to do well.
But Wild Audio has more extreme designs, I think.
That's the point. Ola did it right.
Right, right. I think if you get a little too wacky, it's going to be a very niche market. You have to be a little bit more, you know, middle of the road. If you get too crazy with your design, with, you know, the crazy ornate look to the horns, the oversized inlays, the bullseyes, and other like detailed painting patterns. It's a little too much for a lot of people. Where the Solar guitars are a Strat shape, a little pointy to say on metal, sort of a very stripped down, you know, look to it, and it's a satin finish.
Yeah,
it's like gloss.
Yeah. I think, I agree, everything you said. I think Zach was banking on the fact that he's Zach Wild, right?
And he is going to get some sales, but you got to break out beyond Zach Wild, right?
Right. It's like, it's like, it's like, it's like, it's like, it's like,
certain base. You got to branch a little beyond that. And I think that's where he couldn't do, because he was just, like I said, it was a niche. It was just a little too niche.
It's like selling double neck guitars. It's a niche of a niche.
There you go. It's a niche of a, exactly. That's a great analogy.
Yeah. With that said, Wild Audio had one guitar that I saw at Summer NAMM, which was really nice. It was like a Tobacco Burst. Les Paul looking. It was nice. It still had the horn, right, but it didn't have the crazy paint job, you know. Terry Bear says, Ola has solid design. Zach went too extreme. Too bad he has a few decent models, but again, I can't see Wild Audio lasting. Well, maybe it can last. You know, here's the bottom line. If a company has deep pockets, and I'm sure Zach has deep pockets, you know, he is successful, he may be able to turn it around if he comes out with something that will appear to the greater market. But I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens. Listen, I think what happens is people see Eddie Van Halen selling these very specific striped guitars, and everybody wants one. But there's only one Eddie Van Halen.
That's, yeah, we were talking about that before.
Yeah.
He really is a cut above, at least for a lot of guitar players out there, which is an aging group. But he's still very influential. I mean, there's young guys coming up who are still very influenced by Eddie Van Halen.
Yeah. I mean, there's only one Eddie Van Halen. It's the bottom line.
Right.
And you know what? And I've said this before, right? You know, when you look at the guitar gods, he's one of the few that my wife knows songs that he played. I don't think my wife could pick out a Steve Vai or Joe Satriani song out of a, you know, but she'll know right away a Van Halen song.
Yeah.
You know, not only was he an influential guitarist, the music was for the masses.
Yeah, no, they were a commercial success without a doubt.
Yeah. I mean, every checkbox was, they did right.
Right.
Brolio says, TK, didn't you say that Wild waited too late to come out with his brand? If I said that, I don't know what context I would have said that. I don't know if it's ever too late. Maybe I said that in response to something. I'm not sure.
You know what I think we were talking about? I think we were saying that, I think I remember this. We were saying, like, you know, Zach is hot and everything, but was he a little bit hotter back when Ozzy was hotter? In other words, they had fresh new songs, probably more like, quite frankly, the early to mid 90s, right? That's sort of like was Zach heyday with
right.
No More Tears.
No More Tears.
Exactly. So if he had come out at that time, you know, maybe, but you know what would have happened. Sharon would have said, oh, no, we own that.
Right.
He had to get out from under Ozzy. Anything he did, Sharon would be like, oh, no, any fame or money you get is directly from us.
Yeah.
So we want, that's our money. And so, like, he had to get out, I think, from underneath that. And then come out with his guitar company. But by then, he doesn't have the Ozzy name, like, he's got Black Label Society, and they're a very popular band. I have a lot of friends that really love them.
Yeah.
But they're not as big as Ozzy. I mean, if it's a numbers game, you've got to admit Ozzy's got better numbers than they do.
Of course. Black Label, I actually happen to like Black Label. I think they make really good, heavy. It's like a Black Sabbath 2.0, just real modern, heavy, drone-y sounding a metal. And I like that.
Yeah.
But yeah. Well, you know what?
The problem is the Black Label came out after their time. If they come out in the 80s, they probably would have been a hit, right? Yeah. But they come out.
Well, so- I don't know. I don't know if they would have been a hit. They were a hit because Zakk Wylde was in it.
Right. Who had already built up a name, right? So chicken and the egg syndrome, right?
Yeah. You know, he, you know, same thing. You know, there's when you start playing War Pigs, everyone's like, you know, I don't think a single Black Label Society will get an auditorium of people going crazy like Black Sabbath, you know. But then again, time makes things more successful, right? Let's see. Terry Bear says, also predict Chapman's going to take a downturn due to stale product line and management. And in 2018, I predict Harley Benton stuff will keep getting popular. Huh. Interesting. What do you think about that, Pixie?
You know, I don't know. Chapman's got a good base, maybe not so much in the U.S., but he's got a really growing base in Europe, without a doubt. You know, they,
because he's got the massive push from Anderton's, which is half owner of Chapman Guitar Line.
Right, right.
It may be the biggest house brand out there.
Yeah, yeah. So you know, they just revamped their line, and it seems like they did well in 2017. They revamped their line for 2017. I don't think they're going to feel a need to revamp it or even make a lot of changes for 2018.
Right.
Will be pretty much the same. Maybe introduce a new color or whatever.
Yeah.
And they'll just they'll keep going on, and they seem to have some love out there.
Yeah. I mean, guys got, what, 600,000 subscribers? So
yeah,
600,000 people click subscribe. If you could sell, you know, even just a small percentage of guitars to the people that like, that are his fan base, then, you know, he's got a business model.
Yeah, but I think he's got to get beyond that. I think he would even say, you know, he's got to get it so his guitar is good enough that somebody who doesn't know Chapman walks into a guitar store and is just checking out a bunch of guitars.
Right.
Pick up his guitar. And they don't buy it because of Rob Chapman. They buy it because they like the guitar.
It's interesting because if you look at his business model, he went after, you know, Rob started from the bottom like all of us, right? But as soon as he hit, you know, kind of internet celebrity status, he targeted, like, all his endorsed artists are million plus subscribers. So his go-to-market is very obvious, right? Like, Frog Leap is an example, million plus subscribers. He gets Chapman guitars, right? Who's the other one?
Jared Dines.
Thank you, Jared Dines. He'll play Chapman guitars. The other one, real talented. I'm totally drawing blanks. Who's the guy? Real talent. He did the banjo.
Rob Scallon.
Rob Scallon, right? I mean, million subscriber people. And I think they're, you know, he's trying to tap into their communities. Because if Rob Scallon is playing a Chapman, then a million plus people that clip subscribe for Rob Scallon will maybe want to buy a Chapman. That's right. Their strategy.
Right, right.
You know.
Oh, absolutely.
But the question is, you know, like you said, you know, it's very easy for people to see that. You know, there's a relationship, that back-end relationship, right? But the question is, if somebody who doesn't know Rob Scallon walks into a guitar center, is that the guitar they're going to want to buy? That's the question.
Yeah, well, that's where the styling and quality and all that stuff comes out, where the guitar, they're like, you know what, I just like the look of this.
Right.
I like the feel of it. I like the, you know, everything about it. This guitar is really speaking to me in terms of its design. That's what you got to get to.
Here's the thing, right? When I walk into a guitar, I'm using Guitar Center for no particular reason. I walk into a music store. I see a beautiful PRS on the wall. When we saw the PRS at GitCon, that 594, everybody loved that guitar. And I guarantee, thank you, Black Corvo, not a single person said, oh, you know, I like that guitar because I saw this guitarist shred on it. Had nothing to do with anybody. People liked the guitar because the guitar was gorgeous.
Right. It was a little pricey,
but it's a it's a guitar. But my point is, it wasn't an impulse buy. It wasn't tied to your favorite YouTuber.
Right. Right. No. You absolutely. It was a killer guitar that when you picked it up, you were like, wow, yeah. This is really amazing.
That's right.
Out, but feel that when you picked it up. Solid rosewood neck, if I remember correctly, and just had that 10 top, and it was just, oh, it was beautiful.
Yeah. And I think forget about Chapman, any guitar company, that should be the goal.
Right.
Is can you create a product that anybody would be interested in buying it because you've done a good job?
Someone said in the comments, but the price, right? So that's what, it's like when money's no object, oh, you can get a nice guitar. It's when money is an issue and you have a budget and now you're like, okay, well, I have, you know, $800 to spend, or I have $1,200 to spend. There's a lot of guitars in that price range.
So let's have that conversation. that guitar, the 594, we all liked it. Everyone liked it. It showed up in everybody's video. If you made a video at GitCon, you probably had that guitar, unless you were from the pedal show that they only used their Strat and Tele, right?
I used that Ibanez Joe Satriani a few times.
Yeah, yeah, you like that. You should have, I think that's in your future.
Yeah, well, we'll see.
Yeah, so, honest question. That guitar, the way it looked, the way it felt, the way it played, can you buy all of those feelings that you had for that guitar in an $800 guitar? I know you could buy a good guitar that will play and sound like a good guitar.
You're not going to get a guitar that nice for $800, not even close.
How much will you need to spend that if you put a blindfold on, you would be equally satisfied?
Yeah, you probably got to spend, I got to think, north of $2,500, maybe even north of $3,000.
Agreed. Agreed.
Yeah.
And the reason why I walked you down that road is because to demonstrate to everyone here that PRS is maybe one of the rare few that truly, like, the warrants the price. If you want that level of quality, you're gonna be, like you said, north of $2,500 to get there.
Right.
You know.
Right. And, you know, you would expect it just because of the appointments of that guitar, especially that particular guitar with the solid rosewood neck, and everything was just a little bit nicer, and it was, you know, the 10 top, and I mean, the list goes on. That guitar had a lot going on.
So I love the comments. Mad Raj is saying, no. Boxes. Yeah, Mad Raj is like, no way, $600 for a PV Vandenberg, that's all you need. And you know what? I don't disagree with you. There's a lot of guitars that you could spend $500 on who will get the job done all day long.
Oh, I have a bunch of guitars that I spent $250 on.
The difference is
killer guitars.
That 594 massaged your fingers and your eyes.
Oh yeah. No, no. No, that was that's what marketers would call an indulgence.
That was an indulgence. Yeah.
That's how they would market that. Indulge yourself.
Yeah, that's right. Because you know what? You can't sell value, right? You can't sell affordability. This is all about pure indulgence. That's funny.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how they sell chocolate ads to chicks on TV.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, indulge yourself. Yeah. Oh, yeah. If you watch any ad for, like, candy or chocolate...
Yeah.
Always like an indulgent moment to myself.
Right.
As a woman.
Well, that was like Calgon, take me away, right?
Yeah, you're right. Exactly. An indulgence.
Right. The soap was, we'll take you to a dreamy place.
Yeah. Because I'm worth it.
Because I'm worth it.
Right. That was a marketing slogan for the longest time, because I'm worth it.
Right. Right.
That was a shampoo. Was that a shampoo ad?
I don't remember. So Terry Bear says, yes, the Tone King, that's just it as well. Chapman prices have been not so consumer friendly, and how many consumer designed by voting are going to sell? I don't see a lot of giving back.
Well, his last round wasn't designed by voting. His last round, they hired a designer to come in and design those guitars.
Why would they have done that when their whole thing is about, because they need to run a company and make it profitable?
Yeah, I think that's what it was. I think they wanted to feel like, you know, okay, the crowdfunding, you know, sourced design was cool. But what I got from the last NAMM show was that they just hired a designer.
Who did they hire? Do you know?
European guy.
Yeah.
Or Brit, maybe. And they brought him in, or Italian, right? Italian designer.
I'm going to get a drink. Hang on.
I'd have to double check that, but I'm pretty sure that that's how it went down. Now I can hear myself echoing because he put the headphones by his microphone. Anyway.
So let me ask you this. Were they forthcoming about the fact that they had a designer do that, that it was not part of the whole?
They weren't to me.
Mm-hmm.
They were to me when I was talking to them.
They were or were not?
They were.
Oh, they were. Okay.
Yeah, they're like, you know what? And I think when they sat down with the dude, I think what they wound up doing was working. And it might have been a designer from World Music, to be honest.
Cheers, everyone. Cheers.
And I think they I forget. They it was something like when you buy a guitar from World Music, you can just get a bunch of boxes. I want the regular tailpiece. I want the premium tailpiece. I want the regular pickups. I want the premium pickups, right? Mm-hmm. And then they have tiers. And I think with them, as they were explaining it to me, they just said, you know what, let's just go top tier because we feel like people, we did the bargain thing and we got X amount of mileage out of that, but that sort of wore itself out. Now they're going for more of a premium market and they had to do that because if you're selling the same guitar over and over and over again, at some point, that market sales going to go down. So you revive it by changing all kinds of things. Price point, you lower price point, higher price point, and you're just appealing to a whole different market. It's like, yeah, I have a $500 Chapman, but I never thought about an. I didn't even have like an $1,100 Chapman available to me, right? They didn't even make a guitar like that. Their most expensive guitar was like $800 or $900.
What's their most expensive guitar today?
I think it's up a good $200 or $300.
But No, Chapman. How much is Chapman's?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying like over prior models, their most expensive guitar was maybe $899, and now it's like $1,299 or something like that, or $1,099.
So for $1,299, you could buy a Gibson Studio.
Right, but a person who buys that might look at a flame-topped, carved-topped, super strat, neck-through design and say, well, this is much better than a Gibson Studio. A Studio is a little bit more traditional guitar, and I want a more modern one. So, granted, if they were making that Les Paul style like they were making, they were just trying to compete with them like that, yeah, they would probably have a tougher time competing. Mm. But I think they tried to move towards like a carved top, you know what I'm saying? And a thicker, like a real top instead of a veneer.
Yeah.
So they tried to like up their game.
I never liked... not trying to bash anyone, just to be crystal clear here. I never liked their single cuts. I like the double cut, like the ML1. In fact, I have the Hot Rod. I like that guitar. I like the Cap 10. It's very Strat-esque.
Sure.
The single cuts, I'm not a fan. They had that like that dip in the cutaway. It looked like a cheap single cut. It looked like an ESP LTD 250 series guitar that they sell, that ESP sells for $250, $300.
Have you played one? Did you ever pick up one up?
No. After the last NAMM incident, I didn't go back.
So I had never tried one.
Okay.
I want to say not last NAMM, but maybe the NAMM before that.
Were they nice?
Well, I had never picked one up, and you know who was there was Garrett Peters, and that's his guitar. When he has a Chapman, he has that single cut, right? And was it the ML2 or whatever it was, right?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but yeah.
And I was like, oh, yeah. I go, oh, that's yours. And he's like, yeah, yeah. And I picked it up. That thing was so heavy. That was like a 9-pound guitar easily. That thing had some weight to it. That was solid mahogany, and boy, you could feel it. So I'll give it that. I did like the sort of, it felt like nice and heavy, like I would expect them a single cut like that. So I'll give them props for that. And I don't think it was a bolt on. I thought it was a neck through design on it. So, you know, not completely neck through, but you know what I'm saying? Like a neck and a set neck.
So Pixie, let me ask you something and we'll open the question up for you guys and gals as well. It's no secret that World Music, and by the way, Ola England isn't making his guitars in World Music. And for that, I'm actually very happy because it's like yet another guitar out of the same factory. It gets tiresome after a while.
He went to Indonesia, right?
He went to Indonesia. In fact, he's using the same factory that Washburn uses. Wow. And if anybody's ever played one of the Parallax Washburns, quality instrument.
Sorry.
Real, God bless you. Really, really nice instrument. So,
it's always two.
Bless you. Yeah. So I was really happy to have heard that because I don't really have any complaints with Washburn. I own several of their guitars.
How does Washburn feel about him making an end around and going directly to the factory where Washburns are made? And I wonder how they feel about that.
I don't know the answer to this. I'm speculating, to be crystal clear, but I think they probably helped him.
Yeah, it seems like they were on very friendly terms.
Yeah. Washburn, the people at Washburn are really good people. And I think Washburn is has been getting into more and more acoustics. That's a fact. Less electrics, more acoustics. Washburn's a big company, and they need to follow the trend. My guess is that they probably helped him spin this off into his own thing. I think it was, again, I'm speculating. I think they probably encouraged and or helped him with this.
That makes a lot of sense. That's probably the best working theory I've heard so far.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know that, but I would put money on that theory. I know the guys at Washburn, and I never asked. There are some things that's just not my business. But they love Ola, right? They have a tremendous amount of respect for him, and Ola's using the factory, and Ola still has nothing but nice things to say about Washburn. So I think there was a mutual thing there that came to be.
Yeah. I agree. That makes sense. It really does.
Yep. So here was the question, right? And I've said this before. This is nothing new. With all the guitars that come out of world music, is it tiresome? Do they start to feel the same after a while? I know it's a different recipe. It's different models. Listen, Diamond guitars come out of world. I love Diamond guitars. And that's not just because I'm friends with Jeff. I could have any guitar I want, but I genuinely like him. I get excited with his guitars because I like the designs in general. I'm being very general here. Is it too much coming out of the same place? What's your opinion? And the reason why I'm asking this is when you take a new company like Chapman, do we really need another guitar company coming out of the same place as companies PRS, Dean, Diamond, like you have the big boys, do you really need another guitar coming out of the same place?
Yeah, I mean, only if it differentiates from the other guitars that the place is building, right? Mm-hmm. So I think the PRS stuff is, you know, unique enough that, they sort of hold their own. And I don't really, I can't say like I pick up a, the last time I was at NAMM, I picked up their new line of, super strats at the Chapman booth, that new, updated line. Mm-hmm. And I can't say when I picked it up, wow, this sort of feels like a PRS SE.
Okay.
Nothing like that. So I it's like, I think where you would see it more is if everybody used like their stock pickups, right?
Right.
So, like, then you would see like more similarity, but I don't even think people do that. I don't know. Maybe there's a stock bridge and a stock neck and you get to brand it whatever you want, but it's still the same pickup. So if you're in a PRS guitar, they call it something. But and then the Chapman guitar, they call it something else, but it's literally the identical pickup.
So the reason why I asked the question is, like we said before, right? You have $1,000 in your pocket. This goes back to the whole Ibanez Kiesel video I did, wildly misunderstood. Jason McNamara took the video down, okay? Even though, despite the tone of the video, the point, I think, was made in terms of you could buy a USA made custom shop guitar with good quality from Kiesel's factory, right? The point I'm trying to make here is this: if you have $1,000 in your pocket, I personally like variety where you could get a Kiesel. You picked up the Kiesel over here, right?
I love that Kiesel. I thought
it- I know I wish the camera was rolling because you were so sincere. You're like, dude.
I had an unbridled enthusiasm.
Yeah, yeah. So you get a thing like Kiesel, right? You don't have to buy a fancy one. You could get one for $1,000, right? And you could only get that from Kiesel, right? Because it's their factory. I got really excited when we were at Warwick because you got to see and feel guitars that are only made by them. And that's what's really exciting was the craftsmanship from very, very specific factories. It's very exciting, you know.
Yeah, I was impressed by that Kiesel. I really was. The fit and finish and just the feel of the whole thing.
And it's a simple guitar.
It was simple guitar and it sounded great.
Yeah.
I was impressed.
So let's go back to 2018 predictions. If you had to predict two new guitars that you may have next year, Pixie, what would they be?
Well, I think a PRS is almost a given at this point. The only thing that will...
Like an S2 or a high-end?
No, not a high-end, but, you know, probably like a Custom 22 or a Custom 24. Probably Custom 22.
Do you like the S2s?
Yeah, the S2s are fine. I just think that if I'm going to get a PRS and people have been contributing, you know, towards my PRS fund, it'd be a disappointment if I got an S2. They'd be like, what are you doing, dude? So I would feel the need to get, you know, something nice. And you can get something nice. I ran across a photo I had did a screenshot from a couple of PRSs that the time they were listed, I just didn't have the cash to get them. But they were for short money. And by short, I mean under $1,500. And they had a goddamn 10 top on it. And it was...
Where was this?
Guitar Center used. And, you know, it sold pretty quickly.
Gotcha.
I knew it would. You know, it was Guitar Center used. I knew it would sell quickly. And it sold quickly. But the bargain was there.
Right.
For a couple of days, I had the opportunity to pick that up, and about 3 days later, it was gone. I knew it wouldn't last.
Mm.
And sometimes they don't last for minutes, and they're gone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Really depends on the guitar.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're out there. The bargains are out there. And so I don't feel the need to rush and get just any PRS.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's got to be a guitar. I really am gaga over the look about. It's got the appointments that I want, and I get it at a good price.
Cool. How about a second guitar?
Second guitar gets a little trickier. That one's easy.
Mm-hmm.
Second guitar is a little tougher. I probably have a 100% probability of getting a Harley Benton at some point in the next 6 months.
Gotcha.
And I probably have 100% probability of getting a Dan Electro in the next 6 months, probably after the NAMM show.
Gotcha. So in the link of this video is a link to Thomann. Click on the link and check out the Harley Bentons. I actually have that in the video description. I have to say for little money, they're interesting. they're interesting guitars, the Harley Bentons.
Yeah, they're funny because they're tribute guitars, a lot of them. Les Paul shape, SG shape.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, straight up PRS shape. You know, they're all tribute stuff. But they change them just enough so they don't get any flack.
And they're priced right.
Oh, my God. They're priced better than right.
You know, you think about the what are the sites, the Chipsons?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like buying a non-Chipson because it says Harley Benton.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and some of them are even cheaper than the Chipsons.
Yeah.
Even Chipson isn't doing that SG, that triple pickup Les Paul Custom E1 or 62, whatever that was, Les Paul Custom with the SG and the white and the block inlay and the triple pickup and all that stuff. They're not doing that for $150.
Right, 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 right.
They're just not.
Yeah.
So...
It's pretty fascinating that
it is. It's a testament to manufacturing efficiencies.
Well, that was like when
Philip McKnight and I were in Phoenix, and we went into a guitar center. And I have a video out there. It's called "Is a $99 Guitar Worth the Money?"
Yeah, yeah.
And you really have to ask yourself, how do they do it? Because think about it. You still have the price of the wood, the price of the hardware, the price of the pickups, the price of the tuners, the price of the craftsman. Because even after you CNC it, there's a lot of finishing. How do they do it? You figure for $100, Guitar Center's making a profit. So let's say they're making 30%. They're buying it for 70. The manufacturer has to make a profit. So let's say they're making $20 on it, right? So they're selling it for 50, and the factory that's making it has to make a profit on it. So let's say they're selling it for 30.
Right. So I knew a dude.
How do you build that guitar for $30?
When I worked in the music store, right, and this is in the 80s. This is probably, we've already moved to the big store, because I remember being in the big store when we had this conversation.
Right.
We had two big stores, a downstairs and an upstairs, and we were at downstairs first and then upstairs. So this is downstairs. This is probably 86, 87, 88, somewhere in that range.
Mind if I strum while we talk?
And my friends, the guy who owned the store, he had a buddy who was a shoe wholesaler. Because I remember he came in, we were talking to him. I said, you know, what do you do? Well, you know, what do you do for work? And he's like, oh, I'm a shoe importer.
Dude, I got to say, this feels so, I didn't show this to you.
I know.
This is like a satin back. It feels so smooth. It's crazy.
So he was importing shoes. He was paying, so what's the markup on shoes? He goes, well, I pay about $2 a pair.
$2 a pair.
$2 a pair was what he was paying for shoes back in the late 80s. $1 a shoe. You think about that.
That's slave labor.
It had to be, right? I mean, how the hell else are you getting shoes for $1 a goddamn shoe in the United States? I mean, obviously he was getting them imported, but you got to get them from there to here.
That means somebody is making a nickel a day.
I mean, it's got to be. I mean, it was. I never forgot that. I was like, what?
Well, and you know how much time could go into, painting a guitar, polishing a guitar. Like, there's a lot that goes into it.
Right. Well, it used to be a real big skill set, but now computers have gotten so good. And the other thing is that the CNC machines have just gotten cheaper and cheaper and cheaper.
Right.
Better and better and better.
Well, now with the 3D printing, you could have a 3D printer in your house.
Right.
Someday people are going to, I would predict in the next 10 years, you'll probably have consumer CNC machines.
Well, we talk, oh, you're right. Right. Because 3D printers, consumer CNC. My God. Yeah.
So you could print your own, you want a body, you need a neck, whatever.
Right.
You know? Yeah, Watchman says, we wonder why healthcare costs so much.
It's because your dentist is going to Europe to kill lions. you got some money.
Of all the lions, he killed.
Doing a safari every year. I know. Could you have hit the worst luck ever?
he hit their favorite lion, the country's favorite lion.
He simultaneously shot the lion and shot himself.
That almost sounds like a setup. Like someone's like, yeah, 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 get that one right there.
No, I know. God, that dude.
Oh, man. So, for me, I don't know, man. I like that. I don't know why. I have such poor taste. I like the Jakey Lee Blue Burst that I think he did in Lightning Strikes.
Okay, I'm trying to think of it, but I think I know the one you're talking about.
It's another Charvel.
It's just another Charvel. But it's the right color.
But it's blue. Yeah.
But it's blue.
Is that terrible? I mean, it's...
Yes and no.
You know, it was nice when I was at Summer NAMM and I was with Trushak, and we were in not Carter's, the other place, Gruen's. And I saw the Les Paul, the brown one, and it just, I liked it. It was like $700.
Right.
It was a ebony board.
Nice.
On a studio. And
yeah, that with a lot of the studio, yeah.
What'd you say?
You saying the Les Paul studio?
With an ebony fretboard.
Yeah, but didn't they do the ebony was stock on a lot of the studios, wasn't it? Didn't they have a line, maybe it was the deluxe line, where ebony was like stock for that particular one. You couldn't even get it on a Les Paul standard, right? It was the only way to get it, to get ebony on a guitar other than a Les Paul custom.
Right. Like, and let me tell you, you got to come by another day, dude, just to try some stuff out and hang out. But that guitar plays like butter. It's an older guitar. Of course, they went through it and cleaned it up and polished the frets. But that's definitely a played guitar. It's not brand new. And right. It just plays like butter.
Nice.
You know, plays nice. You know what I did before? I have my pedal board in the back room. And I did some looping with the Ditto in stereo cabinets. Mark Core. Oh, dude, Mark Core, thanks so much, man. Cheers, buddy. Cheers. Thank you. And I played a little some riffs.
That was coffee money for NAMM with Pixie together. So I will be holding you to that.
That will be on me, man. That will be on me. Well, on Mark Core by way of me.
Right.
I would loop, so it was real loud, and then I'd play the drums over my own loop. That was kind of cool. Okay, so Showman Blues says best bang for the buck from Warwick.
Well, I would say from Warwick, they're sort of a regular line, but from the German factory. So they have a Chinese line, don't they, or a Korean line? Don't they do an import line?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think they might. Though they may not brand it Warwick. They may brand it something else. As you know, when you go to the factory, there's two tiers. There's like sort of like production and custom shop.
Team built and master built.
Right. And when you go to the master built, it really does add a lot of stuff for mostly cosmetic. You're going to get an amazingly nice instrument, even with the...
You need to be a big spender.
Yeah, you need to be a big spender. Yeah.
You also need to be...
You want the master built.
You also need to be filthy rich.
You need to be filthy rich and a big spender. That's true. And a billionaire wouldn't hurt.
Yeah. You need to be a billionaire. That's right.
You know.
I have to tell you, I have a confession to make. Remind me of my confession on the Phil-X. You finish your story.
I forget it now. What was I saying? No, I was basically saying that, like you said, the team built, I think, is the better value. The best value from Warwick, I think, is the team built.
Team built.
90% or even 95% of what you're getting out of the master built.
Yeah.
And you're saving, you know, it's not 90% of the cost. It's more like 60% of the cost.
Yeah. You know,
or 65, 70% of the cost. So there's savings to be had for things that are more cosmetic, but take a ton of time to do.
Right. So here's my confession. When I, hang on. When I bought the Phil-X guitar from GitCon, it was the guitar. I collect guitars, in case you didn't know that. And I'm talking to the viewing community. I collect guitars. That's always been my thing. I'm not the greatest player. I'm not in a band. I genuinely enjoy the instrument. It's art. And when I went to GitCon, I had so much fun. It was really, I mean, I think everyone knows it was life-changing for me, right, in terms of what we do here. And I wanted the Memento, and that was the guitar. Everyone played it. Phil-X was the bandmaster for GitCon. So it was Phil-X was the bandmaster. It was from GitCon. It was a master built Framist, which I've never owned, never played a Framist before. And I got to have Phil and Hans Peter sign the master built Phil-X model at GitCon. It was the perfect scenario. That's why I bought that guitar. Now, if I didn't like it, it would be in the case, and I'd feel like I'd have a nice memento from GitCon. The confession is, I love that guitar. That guitar is a phenomenal playing and sounding guitar. That just happened to have been a nice perk that happened. Wasn't why I bought the guitar.
Right.
I bought the guitar because I wanted the collector, you know, the memento from the show.
Yeah.
But dude, I can't stop putting the guitar down. I love that guitar. The Arcane pickups, the construction, the everything about it is phenomenal. I love that guitar. Such longboards, dude. Cheers. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. And we're going to answer your question right now. Best tube amp for metal, clean, and pedal platform.
See, that's tricky because...
Supersonic.
When you get to metal, though, that gets a little tricky.
Supersonic. But the Fender has the best cleans. Right. It's a very pedal-friendly. And right. If you want the burn channel, probably a Supersonic, a nice Supersonic right. something or other.
I originally thought of Fender. I gotta say, even though for metal, it depends on your budget. I mean, if you can buy a friggin' diesel amp, there's that. They have killer cleans.
Yeah.
You know, but it's going to cost you.
I'll tell you what, when you get into like those small, the Classic, I love the Classic. I think people know that of like all those mini heads, the Classic is probably the most versatile. All you really need is a metal pedal in front of something like that and a big old cabinet.
I don't know if you know of Scott Henderson. He's a sort of a jazz fusion player. He's been around a long time.
Yeah.
I saw him recently being interviewed, maybe about a year ago or 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And so pretty recent. I mean, he's had a career since the 80s. And he's like, you know what? I'm going all clean. He goes, I get all my distortion right out of the pedals. He goes, I just found like a super clean amp and I could work the pedals and get my sound that way. He goes, I'm just liking it more. I feel it's more versatile. And he said, I feel it really gets the guitar sound better than when I use the distortion of the amp.
Probably more predictable too.
Yeah, probably more predictable too. That's
he uses, he's a Maxon artist.
Is he really? Yeah, I don't know.
I think he's a Maxon artist. That's how I know of him, actually.
Yeah, he was an Ibanez guy for a while, I thought, playing Ibanez guitars. And then he's had a few endorsements over the years. I found his, I was, you know, cleaning up around here. I found his Hot Licks tape the other day, the VHS tape. I bought the Scott Henderson Hot Licks tape and probably our Star Licks or Hot Licks or one of those from like the late 80s, early 90s.
Got it. Okay. Since TAC178 did a super chat on what was the incident in NAMM regarding Chapman, I will tell you. The incident at NAMM regarding Chapman went something like this. And just to be crystal clear, we made up. There's no hard feelings. Everybody's good. Okay. So just to forward it with that. But what happened was this. I was at the Chicken Picks booth the day before, talking to the Chicken Picks guys.
The day before NAMM opens.
The day before NAMM open. And the guy from Chapman Guitars gave me one of those, you know, don't worry about what's behind me type of thing. Didn't want me to record. And I was very respectful. I said, dude, don't worry about it. I won't record. And he was like literally in my face, because he didn't believe that I wouldn't record. At which point I started to record how obnoxious he was being to me because I was getting insulted. And then the next day I put that little clip on YouTube saying, hey, you know, access denied. And then I took it right down. I, you know, I,
I'm the better person. It just got the best of me. At the end of the day, we're human beings. I was insulted because he didn't trust that I wouldn't record, and he was being, I didn't like how he was being to me. So I recorded him, not the guitar line. And that was that, but I took the video down and it blew up. And, he called me one day and just said, "Hey, listen, there was a misunderstanding. I didn't mean to do that." And I told him, I said, "I didn't mean to put the video up. That's why I took it down." And we made up, and that was that. But that was the misunderstanding. They thought I was there to, you know, leak the line, which I wasn't. I'm a good guy. If you tell me, "Hey, come hang out and enjoy, but save the footage for tomorrow," then that's what we do. I mean, I know lots of manufacturers. They tell me lots of things, and I'm really good at keeping secrets and not telling things that, not talking when I shouldn't be talking. I'm very good at that. And you need to be good at that when people trust you and share with you information that may not be ready for public consumption. But they didn't believe me and, wound up insulting me in the process. So that's what happened. But that was a year ago. We are good. No problems. And that was that. So since you bought that super chat, there's your honest to goodness answer. And that's actually in a video, the same story, maybe a little bit longer, but that was the incident. Yeah. So did I leave anything out, Pixie? That was pretty much it, right?
No, that was it.
Yeah. So, but that was water under the bridge, and everybody's good. What do I think of Solar brand guitars? The Ola England. I love them. I think they're great. We were actually just talking about them earlier. And no problem, Tech. No problem. Solar. I don't think they call it Solar. I think Ola calls it Solar, right?
Yeah, like Ola.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
I'm.
Yeah. So Devin says the new red finish is so cool. Yeah, I'd like the blood red. I've always been a fan of blood red. Kenny B says, "Drink up, get loaded. It's been years." Eve. Yeah, this is first time I had 1.5 on a live show. But you know what? It's New Year's Eve, so why not, right? And I'm home and I'm not driving. So cheers, everyone. Phil Smith says it's a trade show at some point. You need to install the booth, and that's what the day before is made for. It's generally not open to the press. Yeah. Yeah, it's not open to the press. And guess what? I wasn't there to be the press. I was just talking to some people, and, you know, they should have just trusted that I wouldn't have leaked something, but whatever. Did I see the new Charvel Satchel model? I did not.
Yeah, I haven't. I mean, I saw the writing on the wall that he was going to, you know, become a Charvel artist because he had switched to Charvel over Kramer. But I had not seen the new model. Is it up on the website? Engaged. Hold on. I'm going to let him know if they've announced it. Sorry. Oh, the new Jake E. Lee Blueburst is there.
That's the one I'm talking about. That may be in my future.
That's a nice looking guitar.
Do you like that? Do you like it? But that will have to be a friends and family discount. It exceeds the per unit budget.
Well, I'm on the site. I'm not.
Oh, Devin just said they only put it up on Instagram.
Ah, that's what everybody does now.
Showman Pixie, I'm dreaming of you and TDA doing some Everly Brothers live. Nice.
Let me see. Can I search? Everly USA. Oh, yeah. There it is.
That's on Instagram?
It's on Instagram.
Let me see.
I don't know if that's his signature guitar. I'm assuming it might be. It looks like he's at a Steel Panther concert. right, at before a show, and he's sitting, and he's it's you know, it's a tiger stripe a la you know, the like what the Kramers were, right? That sort of tiger stripe. And
In green. Oh, in green.
Looks yellow on my monitor.
Oh, I'm seeing all this stuff here. Everyone could see right. That.
You're looking up Charvel. You got to just go to Instagram and look at Charvel USA's posted. In other words, you're just getting.
Gotcha. So why did he go to Charvel? What happened?
I think it is because Kramer was going under. Oh, yeah, there's another picture of him. With
Kramer's going out again?
Yeah, they're calling it the Yellow Bengal.
Why? So back up. What happened with Kramer?
Well, you know, we don't know what's going on with Kramer. So Kramer, like I pointed out in my video, you know, they hadn't updated their website in 2 years. They had one guitar, two guitars at all of the NAMM show. They hadn't updated their Facebook page in over a year. As I understand it, they started to do that again. Not their website, but certainly their Facebook page. People were, you know, as soon as it happened, people were going, oh, my God, Kramer's back, man. Kramer's back. A lot of stuff, blah, 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 and all this stuff. But I don't know. Are they? Well, you know what? We'll find them.
I'm on the site right now, and I don't know. Is it updated? I don't know.
Go to the news. When's the last time they posted a news story?
2015.
Yeah, that's right. December, the end of December 2015, right? It's somewhere in December, November, or December 2015, the end of the year. Starting in 2016, it looked to me like they stopped.
By the way, that SM1, that is a hot guitar.
Oh, I know, right? You can get those used for around $500 or $600.
Yeah.
It's a ebony fingerboard.
That new sells for $1,000. And in black, it comes with EMGs. It's a gorgeous guitar.
And it's got a like a blower switch on it to like give it a little boost, right? I think it's got a boost on it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's nice. I love the inlays or the headstock. Just a gorgeous guitar. I'm drooling. I want it.
The question is, if we go to Facebook and we look at hold on. What's this? I don't even know. Hold on. I gotta go to this computer. Gonna freaking log me out. Yeah, there it is. So if we go here.
Oh, Philip McKnight covered the Dan Electro 84 guitar. I didn't know that. Huh.
Yeah, well, Kramer Guitars USA updated their cover photo on, but is that the official Kramer page, or is this a page, a fan page? You know, it's like you never know with Facebook. So I'm assuming this is official. Let's see about. Oh, yeah, it says launched in 1984. The official Kramer Facebook page. All right. Well, they're saying it's official. I'll take their word for it.
Oh, man. I'm starting to get tired. How long are we on here, by the way?
I think we've been here at least a couple hours.
2 hours? Oh.
But we've got on around.
That's funny. Jeff Monroe said Kramer's website just saw 200 hits in 30 seconds.
They're gonna, someone over there can be like, something just happened.
Look, it's taking off.
Maybe we get those new models, those orders in.
Yeah.
So.
You just killed Sonar and Cakewalk. Yeah.
I use Sonar.
I know. Same here. I have X3, the last good one.
I think I have, which one do I have here? X3, producer. Yeah. You know, producer?
That's what I got, X3 producer. That was the last good one they made. And once they Gibson bought them and went to a subscription model, I bailed.
Great Vanzini says, I need a big studio clock. What's a studio clock?
I thought a studio clock was one that... no, I'm thinking of a Simpty, like a time clock. Mm. I don't know, maybe he just wants a quiet clock for the studio that doesn't make any noise. I don't know.
So, well, my friends, I think we're going to bring this show to an end. So, why don't you tell me where you're from so I could wish you a happy new year on the way out. And if you have any last minute questions, like Marcor right there, I will be happy to answer them. So, Marcor said, I saw Friedman guitars in Anderton's review. I'm really impressed that they are custom made by Grover Jackson. Is that right? I didn't know that. Interesting.
I don't know.
I don't know much about them, but I'll have to check them out at Winter NAMM. I'll have to check them out. By the way, if I miss your name, just repeat it again in the comment. I'd like to wish everyone a happy new year on the way out. So. Showman Blues, Phil Smith, Braulio, Happy New Year. Frank, Sinner, Michael, Marcor, Pacifica, Gizmo Gadget Geek, Daryl, wow, it's coming in quick now. Scott, Such Longboards from Oklahoma, The Table in Wales, David in Sydney, Great Vanzini, Tyler, Metalhead Hippie, Happy New Year, Jeffrey, Timothy, 48 Diamond, Wade, WeTune, Aaron, EG Region, CR Cook, Bill Smith from Seattle, Wyatt from Kentucky, Jim, Leonidas, Scott, Whip Jr., Mad Raj, of course, Krellbar, Kyle, I don't see you on there at this moment, but Terry Bear, Happy New Year, buddy, Quinton, Gregory, back from Seattle, Shred Before Dead, oh, I like that, that's pretty cool, Cowtown Customs, Dogpa, Kyle, Wow Rock, Time Traveler, Almighty Antichrist, Pacifica. By the way, thumbs up the video. Let's see if we could get 195 thumbs up on the way out since we're all there. You're all here. Do the thumbs up on your way out. There you go. Guys, listen, in all honesty and sincerity, thank you for a great year. This channel wouldn't be what it is if you guys didn't tune in and hang out and participate the way we're all doing right now. I love doing this. Clearly you do too. That's why we're all here. It's kind of a big happy family. And my wish for 2018 is just more of this, right? This right here is good stuff. So thank you for a great 2017. I look forward to a fantastic 2018. And we're going to kick 2018 off with some awesome NAMM coverage. But this channel wouldn't be what it is if it wasn't for each of you. So thank you very much. Kenny B, Island Winder, Scott, Zirkul. Phil Smith said, one big, happy, dysfunctional family. TNT, Watchman for you, Kyle, Jeff, Marcor, and all that. So, folks, thank you. Have a great weekend. Happy New Year. Rock on, and I will leave you all off with one of those bad boys right there. Thank you, Rock On, and we'll see you later. Pixie, you want to say goodbye?
Later, guys, and I will be having a live show tomorrow night at 7 p.m. If you want to hang out, see me there then.
There he is. Okay, guys, later.